long time ago, shortly after World War II, the trains were still running between Newbury and Winchester. The station called Highclere was in the parish of Burclere. We were getting back to normal after all the restrictions of wartime. I remember it all so well. I remember the many buses. We relied on them because petrol was still rationed and there were not so many cars about.
There haven't been any trains through the station for nearly 30 years. But then a lot of things have changed in the village of Burclere since that film was made.
I've lost count of the times I've watched it. I think it's brilliant. You know, it's the atmosphere. And it's nice to hear John Legend's voice again, because the very first time we watched it when I was still a child, you know, and it all goes together. And it really transports you back. It's really lovely.
It always brings a lump to the throat, doesn't it, to think of all those years gone by and to see people who've passed on and to see old friends.
John Legend, son of the late Charles Legend, rector of Burclere Parish, made the film portrait of the village 40 years ago as a silent movie. He added his own commentary to it much later, in 1977.
It was really conceived as a series of sequences of events that happened in the village, and eventually we had enough material to make up a complete film. But we did manage to give a flavour of life in that particular time, 1949, 1950. There were some people who thought that they were going to be in it because they thought I'd filmed them, and they were disappointed that they didn't appear. They'd been left on the cutting room floor. But of course it was a silent film, it was only a home movie, and I read a commentary over the loudspeaker and public address system, and as far as I remember, it was put into the safe in the vestry and forgotten for many, many years. By 1977, people had television sets, and the moving picture was no longer an event. Way back in 1949, it was still something to go to the pictures in your own village. Like everywhere in the country, it is now much more crowded, whereas when the film was made, to start with, we had petrol rationing at that time, so there were very few cars about, and people bicycled everywhere.
Burclere is surrounded by several other small villages and hamlets, including Old Burclere, a mile to the south of the main village, Highclere to the west, and Newtown to the north. Alan Whiting was just a boy when the film was made, but the family tradition has carried on.
My uncle delivered the milk round the village and it was unpasteurised. We're doing the same thing around the village as what you done 40 years ago, really. We just pasteurise the milk, and we've just got bigger machinery and more cows. A lot of the people in the village, the older people, they always remember my uncle, and how he delivered the milk, you know, in the winter, snow, rain, every day without fail, you know, and my brother does the same thing. And I think the older people in the village talk to my brother as if he's a sort of newspaper chap who walks around the village and knows everybody else, as if someone's ill in the village, they get to know, and things like that. I knew there was a film of the village 40 years ago, and I knew my uncle was in it. But now I'm more eager to see what it was like, you know, in those days.
Thank you. Bryony Canning was only 10 years old when the film was made. She still lives in the village. Much of her spare time is spent enjoying the countryside surrounding Burclere.
It's a lovely, peaceful area, and it enables me to carry out some of my hobbies. You know, looking at the flowers, photographing, and just sitting and thinking. Can I take a photograph? Because it's nice to look back and remember what you've seen, and to have a record of what you've done anyway. I think some of the children have a little snigger sometimes when they see me laid flat on my stomach trying to get a real good close-up. But I don't mind being laughed at. I think the reason that it's called Burclere is that the whole area was forested at one time, and Burclere is a clearing. Kingsclere is the next parish along to the east, and Highclere is the next parish along to the west. I can just about remember the war, but I didn't know what it was. We had some Polish refugees. I didn't know why they were there, and I do remember the gas masks and things like that, which I think most people do. But we were never made aware of the war taking place. I don't remember the actual making of the film, but it was quite an unusual experience for us to see ourselves on film, because, you know, television wasn't about. And it was unique. My younger sister and I are also in the fancy dress at the flower show. I'm a news agent, so I've got newspapers and magazines pinned all over me. And my sister's a sweet shop, because the sweets had just come off a ration, and it was really lovely to be able to have a tray with lots of sweets on. I shouldn't have been on that bus, really, because I lived too close to the school. That was obviously to try and get as many children as possible onto the bus, or as many of us tried to get into the film as we could. But I lived fairly nearby, so I didn't really need to use the bus. We used to walk to school. I wouldn't say the atmosphere has changed. We're still very much a small community, you know. I think socially things have changed quite a lot, because, you know, you used to have your upper, middle and working classes, and never the twain shall meet. Now, it's much more integrated. People mix. We're all equal now. It was really a nice piece of social history. And of course, it's lovely to look back and see all the children that I knew. Every time I watch the film, I seem to see something new, especially people. I very often recognise somebody again, you know. It reminds you of what the village was like in the past. Although it hasn't changed a great deal, there are changes, and it's nice to see the thing as it was.
40 years on, the primary school is still there, educating the same number of children today as in 1949. Mary Cornwall remembers the meals served there.
We always knew when the school dinners had arrived, because we could smell the cabbage, and they weren't very nice. We were very lucky, I suppose, to get school dinners, but it was just after the war. Food was still rationed, but we were able to get our dinners. I remember having to queue and being petrified that one would drop our dinner. I believe it was potato and rissoles. I'm not certain what the vegetables were. I didn't like the meat. It was all stringy, so I used to put it in my pockets. I'm glad to say my three children who attended the school, I never found any meat in their pockets. So school dinners have improved greatly.
The other set piece was, of course, the main big sequence in the school playground. Well, no problem there, because Mr. Culling, the headmaster, who was a great friend of my father's, was delighted at the idea of having his school shown off and looking good. And I spent probably a couple of days in the playground. I probably spent an hour or two with the children, just letting them get used to me. And so when we did finally shoot, they seemed to be completely relaxed.
We played Ring a Ring of Roses, Miss Muffet, Farmers in His Den. That was a great favourite. Something in and out the dusty bluebells, and skipping games. The children still bring skipping ropes to school. But there don't seem to be so many organised games. They seem to go off in their little groups and chat amongst themselves. The headmaster was very strict, Mr. Culling. I remember him very well. There seemed to be a lot of school discipline in those days. He shouted a lot. I remember he had a cane. I think some of the big boys fell victim to that cane. I've been very lucky to have lived here, to have brought my three children up in Burclere, and they've attended the village schools. I'm lucky never to have had to move.
There was the scene with Henry Game, the gardener, putting sticky tape round his fruit tree in order to prevent it from being affected by various species of fly and insect. He, being a theatre man, a bit of a thespian, I thought, well, let's get him to do a sequence for us. And in fact, it didn't work particularly well with audiences when the film was shown, because he was a man who wasn't so well known in the village, but they were amused by it. We certainly milked it for all it was worth by putting it into the film three times, I think, and it certainly added something. There was that sequence of Trevor Jackson walking up the hill, delivering the mail, and he comes up to camera and he mops his brow. And the audience absolutely raised the roof. They thought it was the biggest laugh in the world, because Mr. Jackson was not known to go on a bicycle delivering his mail. He always went in his nice little Austin van.
Trevor Jackson ran one of three post offices in the area. This was Newtown Post Office 100 years ago. Today, home to the Hutchins family.
The post office was run in the family almost for 100 years. We thoroughly enjoyed it. We really did. We were the sort of centre of the village. We knew all our customers. We had a lot of customers call in, and we did family allowances, all the post office work. I collected the eggs, and I think Robert was playing about there with his dad. It was quite fun, because it was to have a camera crew come into a village was really something in those days. I took a basket or something, but I think we'd already collected the eggs, so I think I've just pretended to take the eggs out of the nest.
I was three when the film was made. Can't really remember too much about it. I have seen it since on a couple of occasions and remember various people that were in it. I think it's very nice to be able to look back and to see what the village looked like a few years ago. It hasn't really changed a great deal. It's not so much of a close-knit community that it was in the earlier days, as I can remember as a lad. Everything really revolved around the post office and the village hall and the church, which doesn't really happen so much nowadays. I think I'm fortunate in actually being able to continue farming and to be involved in farming much more than my father was. I have on occasions thought, when one travels around the country and sees other much more idyllic places, sometimes I think I'd like to move, but having said that, my roots are here.
The traffic has increased so much. I think really it is the cars that have spoilt the villages. The children used to ride on their bicycles up onto the common and up and down the road here with no worry at all, but that would be fatal today.
Author Richard Adams lived in Newtown in those days. It was at neighboring Watership Down, overlooking the villages, that he was inspired to write his famous novel.
Well, when I was a little boy, my father was a country doctor who had rounds to make visiting patients in this part of the world, anywhere between Wash Common and Whitchurch. And if there was nothing else to do in the holidays, I very often used to accompany him in the car. I remember seeing a pair of weasels playing about the road once, that kind of thing. Watership Down lies about a mile from where we're standing at the moment, although it's part of the crest of the Downs that runs all the way down into Sussex. It occurred to me when I set out to write the book that it would be very nice to set it all in a real topography. And the story of the book takes the rabbits from Sandleford Warren over near Wash Common, right across this country, and finishes up on Watership Down. I improvised it off the top of my head while I was driving the car. My little girls asked me to tell them a good long story to while away a journey to Stratford-on-Avon. We were going to see the Shakespeare. So I was driving up the M1 when I first started talking about Hazel and Fiver and the other rabbits. And when it was all finished, it took about 3 weeks to finish the whole story, my daughters asked me to write it down, and I really wrote it for them, with little thought of the consequences. It hardly seems to have changed at all. People's lifestyle has obviously changed a great deal, and roads have been put in, cars go much faster. My father, when he was going on his rounds, seldom exceeded 35 miles an hour, if that. Ways of life and prosperity have changed, but the topography and the look of the Downs and the country between the Downs and Newbury doesn't seem to me to have changed very much at all.
The village of Burclere has always been dominated by Highclere Castle, 2 miles to the west, owned for centuries by the Carnarvon family. John Day has been the castle's official electrician for the past 62 years. He and his wife Amy have lived here for most of that time.
Back in the old days, they used to have various employees live near to the house. I was an electrician and was right near the job. The gardeners were fairly near too, you see, and the butler and so on. I knew when she was very small, because her parents were friendly. They lived at Burclere, you see, which is only about 2 miles away. So we used to meet occasionally from time when we were tiny tots. Yes.
But then he didn't look at me much, and I was a bit disappointed. And when I got in my teens, he looked a bit more, and we got on better.
That's right, yeah. I suppose we used to have tennis and cricket and so on, and flower shows every year. Back in those days we had, and there was quite a bit of rivalry over the shows, the vegetables and the races and one thing and another. Well, we knew most people back in those days, which is more than we can say today.
They all put their vegetables in, you know, and some weren't always very happy, thought they ought to have had something else.
The children had their sports and the grown-ups, you see. The children, the boys and girls had their races, and the grown-ups, tug of war for the men.
John Day's honey won prizes at the Burclere Flower Show.
I used to have 5 stocks, but latterly I've had to reduce because I've got a touch of rheumatism in my hands, and it becomes a bit difficult sometimes because when you get super honey, it weighs about 30 pounds, and it's not easy to lift off at the top, you see. You get used to them after a time, and they get used to you too. There's a certain way of handling them, they get used to it. Yes, it's a hobby and a pastime, and we get quite a bit of excitement from it at times. This morning about 7 o'clock I came out, I could hear them. Have a bright night, work all night, you can hear them.
I suppose you could say that the main finding quality of the parish was the 3 churches. Otherwise, it's a very disparate community, a very loose community, because there's no centre to the village. There's no little duck pond with pretty houses all round. And it's just a straggly community. Always after morning service, there was a gathering of people outside the church. And they used to gossip for 10, 20 minutes. And they would collect their bicycles and sail off into their various homes. I suppose you could say that going to church in those days was a social event, particularly in the country. The trains were infrequent. 6 trains a day each way, I seem to remember. And they were generally 3 coach passenger trains with about twice the number of passengers.
This is the first time back. I used to go to the box quite a bit because I couldn't keep away from it for years after. It was more easy to get to it than it is now because it's private property, you see, now, than on the box. I missed it for years. Yes, I did. I missed it for years. It was good old days. We used to have the engineering department here, and they used to put a little trolley on the line. Then we used to have about 4 passengers up and 4 down a day. Well, that wasn't a lot, you see. Providing you'd done your job, you was your own boss, you see. And you had so many rules and regulations, you had to make sure that you'd done that. You had to do the job, too.
Forty years after John Ledyard's film, the village of Burclere appears unaffected by 20th century man's onslaught through the countryside. It seems to have changed little. It's still relatively quiet and inoffensive. The school, the churches, and the cricket green are still there. The people are busier, more concerned about their own business, perhaps. But family life goes on. The tradition and working routine maintained by the children and their children's children. We can only look back at village life in 1949, captured for one glorious moment in one man's camera, and perhaps reflect that we haven't come so far after all.
It never had any great aspirations as a marvellous piece of filmmaking. It was just a lot of shots strung together. But of course, with the passage of time, it has become interesting because it reflects a way of life of a different era. And for that reason, I think it's got a certain amount of charm.
Well, I think the magic really is that things were so uncomplicated. Life was much more simple. I know it sounds like a cliche, but it was much more simple. We knew our place in life, and really, up to a point, we were quite content with it.
I'm glad he made the film, because Burclere has remained unchanged in quite a few ways. But new people to the village can see how Burclere used to look. I'm sad certain things have changed, but we can never go back, can we?